started this morning by preparing our hearts for worship with the prelude. So that we may bring love and mercy into the world as the body of Christ.
You, O God, who gives us new life.
Rejoice that God has claimed us and named us forever in these waters of grace, not by our own doing or believing, but by God's mercy alone.
You, O God, who gives us new life.
And so, as we begin worship, we give thanks to you, O God. We give you thanks for the gift of water, by which you nourish and sustain all living things. We give you thanks for oceans and lakes, rivers and streams. We give you thanks for showers of rain and the glistening of dew. And we praise you for our everlasting source of living water, Christ Jesus, whose death and resurrection frees us to live as Easter people. You be given all honor and praise through the risen Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Thank you.
holy and righteous God, you are the author of life, and you adopt us to be your children. Fill us with your words of life, that we may live as witnesses to the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with God now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
The first reading is from Acts. Peter addressed the people. You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us? Though by our own power or pity, we had made him walk. The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know, and the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Like him, for we will see him as he is, and Let all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. would invite the children of the congregation to come up at this time. Well, welcome. Good to see you all this morning. Happy Easter. You may say, wait, is that Easter, Pastor Josh? Didn't we have that a couple weeks ago? Yeah, I see some head nods. But one of the great things about Easter is that in some ways, every day is Easter. After our big Easter story, that big celebration we had up here with all the flowers and the great music, one of the good news of that day is that every day after that is still Easter because Jesus is still with us. So in our readings this morning, if you were listening, you might have heard we were talking about some of the times after that wild Easter morning when Jesus begins appearing to his disciples. And right before our story this morning, there's this great story called Road to Emmaus, where there's two folks walking down the road, and Jesus appears to them, and they don't know it's Jesus. No one really recognizes him, and he walks with them, and he ends up teaching them a lot about the Bible, and breaks bread with them, and eats with them, and then when he eats with them, they suddenly recognize him. And then he disappears. That's where our story begins today, is those two followers of Jesus run back to the disciples to tell them that they saw Jesus. And as they're telling the disciples that they saw Jesus, Jesus continues to show up in our lives. And I wonder if any of you can name one of Jesus' miracles. Because that's the thing I want to ask you today. What do you know any of Jesus' miracles? Can you think of any of them? What are some of the stories you've heard about Jesus doing good things? Yes, David. Yes, that is cool. That is a very good miracle, and that is true. And actually, I can think of one with in John where he raises Lazarus, and that kind of resuscitates him, and that would be a good example of that. But today, in our readings, we have another miracle that maybe doesn't seem like a miracle at first, right? All that happens is Jesus eats with them, and says, peace be with you, and he talks about the scriptures, and it says that their minds were open to the scriptures. Well, in our story this morning, the disciples learn more about who Jesus is. And Jesus teaches them. Like, they couldn't just do it themselves, but Jesus helps them see more of who Jesus is, and that is one of the greatest miracles of all. Similar to what you said, Gabriel, of giving you life, is that when we learn about who Jesus is, when we really start about who Jesus is. That's a miracle. That's something we ourselves get to do too. So, when you go today, if you go to Sunday London, I wonder if you can remember that whenever you learn about Jesus, you're participating in a pretty cool miracle yourselves. Think you can remember that? Well, let's pray together. I'll send you on your way. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you that you're a God who teaches us about you, that you show us who you are, that you are a God of mercy, God of grace and forgiveness, and a God who gives us new life. We ask you to always help us know you through Jesus. Amen. Well, thanks for coming out today, guys. Well, grace and peace to you, friends, from the one in whom we live, from the one who have our being. As I look at you this morning, I wonder how many of you out there like a good ghost story. I know there's at least a few of you. There's a time and a place, right? A good campfire, sit around, tell a spooky story. Maybe you're one of those folks that like going to a scary movie. As I was thinking about that this week, I realized I really take for granted myself how much of a prominent place ghosts kind of hold in our culture, and just Western culture in general, in the English-speaking world, of how often we hear about ghosts. Once you start thinking about it, they're everywhere. Oxford University Press even has a published book of scary ghost stories, Oxford Book of English Ghost Stories. And there's ghost tours, right, on trolleys, especially if you go down to New Orleans or some of these historic cities. We live in the area of Civil War ghost stories, of course. You go to the battlefields, you can often get people talking about that kind of thing. There's novels, and hundreds of novels with ghosts in the title. Ghost Town, Ghost Moon, Ghost Riders, Ghost Abbey, Ghost Children, The Ghost Next Door, The Ghost Rider, Ghost Road, Ghost Train, Ghost Ship, The Ghost in the Closet, Ghost Wolf. There's so many types of ghosts out there. Wow. And movies, where would we start, right? There's, I mean, anyone remember Ghost with Patrick Swayze and Demi Moore and Whoopi Goldberg? They're remaking Ghostbusters right now. They did a remake of Ghostbusters with the new generation, and that did really well. So now there's Ghostbusters Part 2 is out there about Ice Age or something. Apparently they're good movies. I didn't want to go see them at some point. Well, ghosts are everywhere. In today's gospel readings, we are told the disciples at first think they're seeing a ghost. And it's not even the first time in this gospel that that has happened. Earlier, before the Holy Week, they were in a boat on the Sea of Galilee, and a storm came up, and Jesus, who had been praying on land, saw they were in distress and walked out to them on the water in this big storm, and saw this hazy figure of Jesus. They thought they saw a ghost, and cried out, for they were scared and terrified. Well, now, after the resurrection, we're told again that they are scared because Jesus has just appeared to them. They were in a locked room after Good Friday, after Easter, in this locked room, being told about these two followers who had just run up to tell them about how they saw Jesus. And as this is happening, Jesus appears again. Right? How could they not think, oh, a ghost? Jesus says, peace be with you, but he might as well have said, boo. Right? He greets them, and they are startled and terrified. They think they're seeing a ghost. So he has to reassure them that he's not a ghost. If you know your resurrection Eve stories, you know this is a common theme. Again and again, in these appearances of Jesus after Easter, people assume Jesus is a ghost, and again, the gospel writers go out of their way and go to great lengths to insist that Jesus is not a ghost. They go to great lengths to insist that this fully embodied Jesus, that Jesus being in a body, is essential to the good news of Easter. He eats fish with the disciples. Well, ghosts can't eat fish, right? We all know that. And he, time and time again, Jesus says, I need some food, right? I need to show you that I can eat. Put your hands in my wounds, right? Touch my hands, touch my side. See that this is my body, not just any body, but the same body. There's continuity with what came before. This is the same body that was hung on a cross. Well, you may have realized all of this before, right? That this is important, or that you notice these details, that yet Jesus comes in body. But have you ever wondered why? Why is this so important? Why is this so important that all the gospel writers and Paul and all the apostles insist? They insist that this is not a ghost. Have you ever thought, well, what difference would that make? If Jesus came as an apparition or a spirit, right? Couldn't that still be good news, right? That he's still alive in some sort of way. Why does it have to be in a body? Especially this old and broken, but now healed body. It even makes its way into our Apostles' Creed. We say it every week, and I wonder, it's easy to say the creeds and kind of just do it rotely, but I wonder if you've ever stopped and paused at the end of the creed we will again say today, and when we say we believe in the resurrection of the body. In the ancient Greek and Roman world, the idea of body and soul being separate things was just taken for granted, right? There's a body and there's a soul, and everyone knows bodies are bad. The material world of creation decays, right? There's all sorts of problems, it's bad. But the immortal soul, the spirit of things, that is good and pure, right? If any of you have read Plato, right? Or any of these old philosophers, right? The idea of the immortal soul, but the world is bad. And I say the ancient drink around the world, but I suspect that's actually pretty still kind of in the water today, right? I think that's still generally how, if you ask anyone out there, or even yourself, right? I mean, I still think that way sometimes, right? That we get into this idea of thinking, well, the spirit is pure, but this world is maybe not so good. But that is not really the biblical view. Throughout the ancient Hebrew and later New Testament scriptures, but it really begins right in the very first book of the Bible, this idea is argued against. That the body and soul are maybe not as separate as we think. The body and material world of creation around us is maybe not bad, but good. In Genesis, God saw that creation was created good, right? We insist on seven times we're told this, and then humans are created, and it was created very good. And this continues into the New Testament. Even though things decay, and we age, and we break, and death pervades everything, biblical writers again and again insist that the material world, our bodies, everything around us in creation is God's and it is good. In defeating death, God is not just preserving a heaven for immortal souls. It's the first act in setting things right, really right. A new creation, right? And there's implications for this, and I'll get to those in just a sec, but I wonder if you imagine heaven, right? And there's nothing wrong with this, I'll say that to begin with. But usually, right, we think of people we've lost and loved, right? They go on to heaven, and we know that we've buried them, or ashes, and put to death here, so we have this idea of separation, but I wonder if that's a little bit self-limiting. We know our loved ones are with God, and, right? We could get the whole mechanism of things and like theories and do a whole Bible study on like time and eternity and how those can happen at the same time, right? But what I want to get at today is why is there such an insistence on these biblical writers that the body part is important? So if we imagine that our loved ones are with God, that is right. But what would it mean if our loved ones are embodied with God? That somehow they are not just spirits floating in heaven, which again I think is what people commonly assume, but that there is actually some sort of, shall we say, new creation. Well, to get at this, maybe there's a poem that I think might help us. It's actually a poem entitled Luke 24, the verses that we have today. It's the exact same passage, and it's a poem on this passage by a woman named Carol Bloor. And she writes, "He could not give up the flesh. In the moments before we leave forever, we want to say what he did. I have hands, feet, bones, touch me. And is there anything for breakfast? We are tethered to tubes, nails hammered hard, spear in our side, soon to pass through, but still this is my body. With a scar on my hand from the bike accident, with lungs shredded from chemo, the broken left foot never quite healed, but still all I have ever known, this is my body. If I rise, let it not be as a ghost. No metaphor for new life, please something like this body, some flesh, something I can understand." Our hope of Easter is bigger, it's deeper than just an understanding of going to heaven, right? Heaven is right, it's not wrong, that's part of it, but if our goal is this otherworldly realm of heaven, separating from all that we have here. Jesus comes and essentially says, that is not, why make that separation? An embodied new creation is a restoration of things. It's not about an escape from this world. It's not about an escape from the brokenness or the ills we see around us, or an escape from the brokenness of our very bodies. As we age, it's inevitable that we start to experience some of that. If we get sick, we experience some of that. And it's not just our bodies, it's the world around us. The wars that people fight, the pollution, the environmental climate crisis. I look at the data of year-to-year warmth, and I confess I get a little bit nervous. It feels to me similar to like the months leading up to COVID, right? Where we saw like crisis on the horizon, but didn't know quite what it would look like. It's scary to actually think about being in this world with flesh, right? It's a very unsafe place to be. And yet Jesus comes and says, peace be with you. And Jesus' peace, we hear in John, is not the peace of the world. This word peace that Jesus gives is not this Roman idea of peace, which is this inner disposition of calmness, right? Again, I think that's probably where we can default to, is this inner disposition of calmness with peace. And again, that's not wrong, but peace, as Jesus says it, is shalom, which is more than just inner disposition. Shalom is a world set right. A world where things in relationship to each other are as they should be. Where relationships to each other are as they should be. It's a world where all is well. All is just and all is fair. All is as it God intends it to be. A greater hope than a world of otherworldly heaven that we can escape to is a hope of new creation. A new creation that is already being glimpsed with this risen Jesus. The first example of what that looks like. It's a world where God comes to dwell with us. God, Emmanuel, comes to us. Not us going to God, but God coming to us. And we catch glimpses, right? We catch glimpses here on earth of kind of little resurrections here and there. I wonder if some of you have stories of that. It's not the full story, right? It's not little things, but those times where we feel God's grace with us, where those times of despair, where a word of hope comes to us, the times of grief, where we feel comfort. Renee Smith-Larsen, I've spoken of before. I really like her book. I keep recommending it to people. She's currently an assistant to the bishop in South Dakota. She was a pastor. And while she was still in seminary, she and her husband were in Haiti when the big earthquake happened in 2010, and her husband was killed, and they had been married just a couple months at that point. And she writes this beautiful memoir about grappling with the tragedy of that, with the incomprehensibility of that. She writes that in those waking moments of despair after the tragedy, when things felt like the world could never be right again, she said, one of my favorite quotes about resurrection ever, in those moments, resurrection tastes like oatmeal and coffee. Seriously, these were many mornings when I thought I could not have risen from bed if it were not for my favorite food and drink. To even have small things to hold on to in such terrible moments, that God can come through the beauty in this world. Resurrection is not a puzzle to be unlocked or figured out, ultimately. Because, right, I don't know what life after death is like, obviously. But it's not for us to figure out this puzzle. It's a promise. The resurrection of new life is a promise that moves us and gives us hope. A hope greater than, again, a heaven we escape to, but rather a place where earth and heaven meet and kiss. I wonder then, as we go forth, like throughout your week, if you'll notice even just little moments of resurrection in your life. Because the implications of this, I think, are important. And I think we do them anyway, but I think realizing why we do them is important, right? If embodied resurrection isn't real, then why does any of this world around us matter? Right? We could all have our pure souls escape and go to heaven. But no. Again, God insists that this world is good, and therefore we take care of each other here too. Even in the waiting hope of waiting for what this ultimate revelation will look like, we wait here, still caring for each other, still caring for each other's bodies, still feeding the hungry, still clothing the poor. Because because that's all part of it. It all matters. Thanks be to God.
Listen to your children pray.
mercy. O God, our Creator, you bring forth all life on earth, calm storms, bring water to harsh places, and protect the climate that this planet would sustain life in all its variety. Lord, in your mercy. O God, our Savior, you offer wisdom and guidance beyond all human knowledge. Instruct lawmakers, judges, and elected officials to make decisions grounded in your justice and care for all people. Lord, in your mercy. O God, our Comforter, you care for all your children. Encourage those who are in times of transition, facing the loss of old ways and routines and anticipating change. Guide those who journey in grief, hope, and uncertainty. Today, especially do we name Judy, Greg, Judy, Carol, Diane, Hines, Marie, Scott, Linda, John, Mary, Wanda, Jonathan, David, Ginger, Nancy, David, Sandra, Ed and Kathy, Dan and Donna, Ren, Colleen, Elvin, Mary Alice, Adele, Robbie, Savannah, Gary, Evelyn and Gerald, Ronald, Ludie, Jean, and Rich. We pray for those we now name before you, either out loud or in the silence of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. God, our center, you bring all people together in you. Help us to remember our identity and purpose in our ministry. Move us to love our neighbors as ourselves and to share in beloved community. Lord, in your mercy. O God, our resting place, your Son Jesus promised that we are held in your love forever. We remember our beloved who have died. As we remember and share their love, comfort those who mourn. Lord, in your mercy.
Into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love, through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
And have a safe trip.
Yeah, where?
He's going to stay. He's going to stay.
Thank you.
there's a bunch of stuff there. It's actually just things we're giving away. Every couple of weeks we drive over someplace and drop off a lot of stuff. So I want to thank you, but check it's not up to date in the bulletin. We do have up to date information. So if you're interested, you have a great one, right? We do have opportunities. So I just want to thank you.
Thank you, Millie. That's wonderful news. Thank you also to those who were able to help out and come to our fellowship soup and dinner on last Wednesday. That was a great turnout, and our planning is very similar to the Lenten night soup dinners that we had without, so far, the Tuesday afterwards. But our hope is to continue doing that more about once a month throughout the summer. Just a great chance to get together, spend some time with each other, have a great meal. So look forward to that coming up in May again. And with that, I invite you to turn to your bulletin for any additional announcements, and we will continue with the offertory.
Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
known to us in the breaking of the bread. Come and eat at God's table. Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Come back on until like 7:30 this morning. There was a tree fell in the neighborhood.